Good day to all of you out there. Today, we are observing Shinran Shonin's memorial service called Ho-onko. And I would like to speak on the aspect of his humility and confidence. The theme of my Dharma talk today is Shinran was humble, but was he confident? And so allow me right now to share a photo of Shinran Shonin. Well, looks like it's not working, so I'm gonna have to dispense with that. So allow me to continue with my Dharma talk. Shinran Shonin was born in 1173 and passed on in 1263. So today we are observing his memorial service, which will be the 757th memorial service of his passing. And this service is called Ho-onko, which in Japanese means, ko means gathering, ho-on is an expression of gratitude for the blessings or the benevolence that he has bestowed upon us, basically through his teaching. So we're saying thank you for the very important teaching that has made our lives more meaningful and has allowed us to realize the most important question in our lives, which is why we are here, how to overcome pain and suffering, and what will happen to us after we pass leave this earth. And so as a priest in this tradition called Jodo Shinshu, which Shinran Shonin founded, I too would like to express my heartfelt gratitude to Shinran Shonin for what he has bestowed upon us. Shonin means saint, and I'm sure that Shinran, as a humble person, would not have regarded himself as a saint, but those of us, we respect him highly, have the tradition of referring to him with the honorific term of Shonin. So I will refer to him as Shinran or sometimes Shinran Shonin. For people who may not know much about Shinran, allow me to say just a few words. He is a very important figure in Japanese Buddhism. He is the founder of the largest school in terms of membership in Japanese Buddhism, which is Jodo Shinshu. Jodo Shinshu means the true teaching of Pure Land thought, Pure Land branch. So we have Buddhism in general, then we have Mahayana Buddhism, a northern school of Buddhism, and within the northern school of Buddhism, there is a large branch called Pure Land Buddhism. And Jodo Shinshu is one of the major schools within that Pure Land branch. Shinran is often compared with another very important religious figure in world history. His name was Martin Luther. And Martin Luther, as you know, is the founder of Protestant form of Christianity. And they have a lot in common. For example, they were both monks or monastics when they were young, but both left that way of life and became follower of the teaching, yet no longer monk or priest, and they went on to get married and have children, and so that makes them very unique. For Shinran, he is the only major monk who founded a major tradition to have left the monkhood and gotten married. Both of them emphasized faith over practice or work. Of course, they practiced, but their belief was that their practice and their work was not the cause for their salvation or spiritual liberation. It was due to Amida Buddha in Shinran's case and God in Martin Luther King. So in a sense, they emphasized faith, which meant that faith was bestowed upon them through the workings of grace, in the case of Martin Luther, and in Shinran's case, he called it other power. Now, as you can tell, I am a priest in that tradition. In our tradition, like Shinran, we are not monks. We are allowed to marry and have family. And so we are like the Protestant pastors. Myself, I have been married for 44 years and have three grown children and now a grandchild. So in a way, I did lead a life of a monk for a short period in Thailand when I was at the age of 23. But I realized that that is not the kind of life that I would like to lead. It's good for some, it fits some people, but I realized that it was not for me. And if I'm gonna be a religious professional, that the only way that I could serve in that capacity would be to have a family and not to be a monk in a monastery. So first, in keeping with the title of the talk, I wanted to address the issue of humility. Remember, the theme of my talk was Shinran was humble, but was he confident? And so let me talk first about, yes, he was humble. He was, that was the characteristic that attracted me to Shinran when I was young. And so some examples of his humility. In a book called Tanisha, which was written by one of his disciples called Yuyan, there is a chapter 6, in which Shinran admits, I do not have a single disciple. I do not have a single disciple. But when in fact he had numerous disciples, that is why his school became the largest Buddhist school in Japan. So why would he say this? His feeling was that it was not his doing, that his effort, that brought all these people to come to learn from him. He felt that it was the working of the other power of Amida Buddha, the transcendent, in a way, cosmic Buddha called Amida. It is not, Amida Buddha is not God in that he did not create the world, but I often say that Amida represents the spiritual working in our lives, and he is personified as Amida Buddha. But anyway, going back to the point, I do not have a single disciple, Shinran felt that it was not his doing, but it was all the workings of Amida Buddha, which means that other factors than himself. And so he was very humble in that sense. On another occasion, which is written in chapter 9 of the same book called Tanisho. Tanisho means lamenting the differences. It was written by Yuyan because he felt that there were so many divergent views from that of his master Shinran, that he wanted to make sure that people understood Master Shinran's writings and then thoughts. So one time, Yuyan, the disciple, asked Shinran, his teacher, about a quandary or concern that he had. And he says that, although I say the Nembutsu, reciting the name of Amida Buddha, Namo Amida Butsu, Namo Amida Butsu, Namo Amida Butsu, I rarely experience joyful happiness. Do I have the desire to go immediately to the Pure Land? What should be done about this? So he felt he had this spiritual experience of spiritual liberation called Shinjin, and which had made him very fundamentally happy and secure, but he was not always, all the time, happy or wanting to go to the Pure Land right away. Pure Land is a realm of enlightenment upon death. So he was he was very much concerned, and he was afraid that he may get scolded. So he kind of gingerly asked that question. And to his surprise, Shinran replied as such, "I, Shinran, have been having the same question, and now you, Yuyan, have the same thought too." So here's this master not scolding Yuyan, but saying, "Oh, I have the same problem, same issue." And then he goes on to explain that, in a way, we are all imperfect. That is why we're not happy all the time or wanting to go to the Pure Land quickly. So, and then he says that it's this very imperfection in us which made us the target of Amida's compassion. If we were not imperfect, then we would not be able to receive the compassion or awaken to the compassion of Amida Buddha. So here that is, so again, he is humble in a sense that he doesn't act like a teacher and scolds his disciples because they don't fully understand, but he is he considers himself on the same level as his disciples. And I spoke earlier about this imperfection. Sometimes he goes even further and say, "I'm a, you know, foolish, ignorant being," because he saw himself as who he is. And this is one of the attractions of Shinran's teachings, in that he acknowledges the fallible, the imperfect, the problematic aspects of a human being. And he doesn't try to, he tries to improve, of course, but he knows that that is very much part of his character of being a human being. And in doing so, he is able to appreciate what others, including Amida Buddha, can do for him. So this famous quote, "Oh, how sad it is that I, ignorant and stubble-haired Shinran, am wallowing in an immense ocean of desire and attachment, and am lost in a vast mountain of fame and advantage." Even though in Buddhism we are supposed to overcome greed, hatred, ignorance, attachment, desire for fame and advantage, but Shinran says, you know, that's how I am. And this honesty, his humility, is very much evident in this famous quote. Let me read it again. "Oh, how sad it is that I, ignorant and stubble-haired Shinran, am wallowing or sinking in an immense ocean of desire and attachment, and am lost in the vast mountain of fame and advantage." So stubble-haired here means that, you know, remember I said he was a monk, so he had a shaven head, but he actually, along with his teacher and his fellow disciples, was exiled to various parts of Japan, And stubble hair means he's not shaving like a real monk, and the hair is growing out, and it's not fully grown out. And so in a way, it's kind of more of a self-effacing term of, for himself. Okay, so we have seen how humble he was. And I think, again, as I said, that is an attraction. That was attraction to me and to many people, because he acknowledges the fact that we are imperfect. But not because someone tells you that you're imperfect, but because he realized it on his own as he tried to overcome them through the rigorous practices of a monk for the 20 years of his life, from age 9 to 29. So through that effort, he realized that he was very, very much imperfect. But again, here is the important thing. He was able to realize the light of Amida because of that. He saw the imperfection, which is like the shadow, because he had a lot of light shining on him. Let's move on now to the confident part. And I believe that he was very confident. He had great confidence in himself because he was secure. In one of the oldest Buddhist sutras called Sutta Nipata, taught by Shakyamuni Buddha, there is a description of what a sage is, and it goes like this: a wandering solitary sage, uncomplacent, unshaken by praise or blame, unstartled like a lion at sounds, unsnared like the wind in a net, unsmeared like a lotus in water, leader of others, by others unled. The enlightened beings call him or her a sage. A sage is someone who is not moved by what others say, either blame or praise. So it's important here to note that a sage is not shaken by blame. And we kind of understand that when people criticize you, ordinary people get very upset and flustered, but a sage would not. But the other part too, the praise, when someone praises you, then you are buoyed and you are kind of elated. But the sage retains this calm peace of mind, either blame or praise, he is unshaken. So this kind of confidence is part of someone who has attained spiritual liberation, and Shinran had done that. And what that meant was that it gave him confidence. It gave him confidence to do things that ordinary people would be afraid to do, such as going against the social norm. For example, I said that he was a monk for 20 years. At the age of 29, he met his teacher, Honen, and he found a teaching in which he can practice and live under as a married person. So he, as a monk, left disrobed and became a lay person and married. And this was a big issue. It was a big thing. In those days, for a government certified monk to leave and even get married. But Shinran was confident in the kind of life he wanted to lead while practicing the teaching of Buddhism. So it took a great deal of confidence on his part to break the social norm and to take a family, take a wife and to start a family. A second example of his confidence of going against the grain, which was very painful for him because he had to disown his son, Zenran. He had a group of disciples in the Tokyo, what is today present-day Tokyo area, and he lived in the Kyoto area, which is 350 miles apart. And amongst his disciples in the Tokyo area, there were conflicts. And so he sent Zenran, his son, to quell the conflict. But it turns out that the conflict grew, and he realized that Zenran, his son, became part of the problem. So he felt the need to resolve this conflict for the sake of the Dharma, the teaching, the Buddhism, his community. So he had to firmly criticize his son and went so far as to disown him because he went against what it was very important for everyone involved, which was the Dharma, the teaching, and the community. So that took a lot of confidence, I think. For those of you who are parents, you can imagine how difficult that would be to disown your own child. But he had to do it because he was confident that was the right reason, right thing to do. The last example of the criticism of his confidence was that he was so confident that he was willing to risk his own life to protect Buddhism against even the emperor. In one of his major writings, called Kyogyo Shinsho, the teaching, practice, faith or Shinjin and enlightenment, he writes, "The emperor and his disciples acting against the Dharma and violent human rectitude became enraged and embittered." So he specifically clearly says that the emperor went against the Dharma and said he was enraged and embittered and really harsh criticism of the emperor, which in those days could end in execution. But Shinran has such confidence in what is important for him and what he had to protect. And so he even went on to express his criticism openly. So those are some of the reasons why I think he felt he had an enormous sense of confidence. So the question is, or the theme of the talk was he humble? He was humble, but was he confident? Yes, he was confident. And I feel that the two are not in conflict. In fact, a person who is confident is very humble. Because of his confidence, he can be humble. Those who are not confident about himself and what is important for him or herself, then that person will not be humble. He would be egocentric. He would be narcissistic. And so these are two sides of the same coin, the humility and the confidence. You cannot have one without the other. And then the final question is, why was he so confident and so humble? And it comes down to the fact that he was assured of, well, let's say he had a deep spiritual sense of well-being, a sense of assurance that he is embraced and protected by, in his case, by Amida Buddha. As to what Amida Buddha is, as I said earlier, it is the personification of the spiritual energy, the compassion that embraces our lives. And you can only experience it no matter how much I talk about it, unless you yourself can experience it, it will what it means. Only by you experiencing it can you really understand it. So maybe perhaps some analogy. Think of a day in your life when you had a deep sense of well-being, quiet joy and assurance. Have you had such a day? I'm sure you have. I thought about many, many years ago when I was still in my 20s, I spent one day at a lake on a very hot summer day, and I just had such a memorable, enjoyable time floating on a raft, lying in the pond. I felt the sun and a deep sense of well-being that till this day has stayed with me. So that kind of well-being is something that maybe you can think about to get a grip on what I mean by being embraced and protected and experience a deep sense of well-being. Another example would be to think of yourself as a wave in a warm tropical ocean. So I came out of the great ocean as a wave, and we exist now as a wave, but we are very much part of the great ocean. Without the ocean, you would not be the wave. And so we reach high, we experience things as a wave during the course of our lives, and eventually the wave will disappear, but it doesn't disappear. You just simply return to the great ocean from which you came. And so Shinran had the sense of security that he came out of the great ocean and he was part of the ocean, and that eventually he will go back to the warm tropical waters. This is another way of thinking about my relationship as a human being, as an individual, and to that great spiritual energy or life, great life, which we call Amida. And so I hope on this day that you can cultivate or become more sensitive to the workings of the workings of compassion and wisdom of Amida Buddha, and find that assurance and in which you can find confidence and become therefore more humble. And if you're confident and humble, you are basically happy. There's a sense of gratitude that comes with it. And so I close with one of the passages that I like about Shinran, and it goes like this. Oh, how happy I am. My mind and heart are planted firmly in the soil of universal vow, and my thoughts flow in the inconceivable Dharma ocean. So that concludes my talk for today on this occasion of the 757th memorial service of Shinran Shonin, someone who lived a life of humility and gratitude and confidence. And I hope that you yourself can deepen your sense of well-being and live a life of humility, gratitude, and confidence. So let us end with Gassho, putting our hands together. Namo Amida Butsu, Namo Amida Butsu, Namo.